before you can understand the good news, you have to understand the bad news. Jesus said the only way you can get these gifts of Christmas, he says the only way to get the gifts of Christmas in this world and the next world, is not just to make Jesus Christ your Savior, but to make him your Lord as well.
Amen.
He even goes as far to say, many will think they're safe, but when they stand before him one day, he'll say, I never knew you. Get away from me, you evildoer. See, my fear is that we've watered down the gospel to such a point, we've watered down Jesus' message to the point that we've given people a false sense of eternal security. If you look at your life, you look at your life and you're living for you, you're living for others more than you're living for Jesus, then you might want to reevaluate your confession of faith. Because if you're living for yourself and you're living for others, then you're not living for God and putting Him first as He tells us to do. He said, to be my disciple, you must pick up your cross and follow me. We forget because we see crosses all the time, and at the time He said that, He hadn't gone to the cross yet. He said, the world will know you as my disciple if you obey my commandments. He said, the world will know you as my disciples by the way you love one another. Aren't you glad he didn't say you had to like everybody? Some people are hard to like. But he does say we have to love everybody, and we should love them in such a way that they don't even know we don't like them. Like I said, you can't understand the good news without understanding the bad news. We ain't here tonight to talk about the bad news. We're here tonight to talk about the good news.
Amen.
Don't unwrap these gifts of Christmas and just leave them under the tree. What good is a gift that's left under the tree? Tonight, our concentration isn't on the bad news. It's on the good news. So we're going to invite you to step out of the darkness and step into the light. But we need the darkness sometimes, and we forget that. Because it's in the darkness that we most clearly see the light of Christmas. It's in the darkness where we see and experience the gifts Jesus offers us this season. What is it that you're waiting for? What is it that's distracting you? What is it that could get you to take your eyes off of the Savior? What's hindering your journey? What's hindering your odyssey, if you will, to the manger in Bethlehem? What expectation are you holding that may distract you from seeing the true miracles of Christmas? To see the miracle of God made flesh in Jesus Christ. We invite you tonight to follow and see Jesus and go into a deeper relationship with God, with the living God. Instead of waiting for a miracle, let's step out of the darkness and allow the light of Jesus to shine in our lives, be bright in our hearts as we accept these gifts of Christmas. But don't just leave them here. Don't leave them under the tree. Because what good is a gift that's left under the tree? Now, if you're visiting with us tonight, we would ask you to please do us a favor and fill out one of those green connection cards. And I know they're in your brochures or in the back, or your bulletins are in the back of the chairs. And I know they're too complicated. All we need really is your name, your address, your phone number, and email address. And I promise you we're not going to blow up your inbox. I promise you that. But we'd like to get to know you a little bit. We'd like you to get to know us a little bit. And in just a few minutes, if you will, just drop it in the basket as we receive tonight's offering. And just for filling one out, there's some bags out front. Please grab one on your way out. Or if you'd like to wait until after the service, just fill it out at the table and grab a bag as you leave. And while you're filling out, I'm going to let you know a little bit about what's going on at the Odyssey Church for the rest of 2016, the whole week that we have left, and then in 2017 as well. First of all, we have on January the 1st, we should start our year off right, 2017, Fun and Fellowship with Joyce Igo. And I don't know if you know who Joyce Igo is or if you've ever seen her before, but she is absolutely hilarious. She writes all her own music. She's got a lot of CDs out. And some of her songs are funny. Some of them are emotional. Some of them are just a great beat to. But every one of them will point you towards Jesus. And I'm just looking forward. She was here last year. She's coming again this year. And she has one of the most wonderful testimonies. She travels around the world. This is what she does for a living. And she contacted infection in Iran, Peru this year, and and she's always blind in one eye, and she's been around the country trying to get eye specialists to take a look at it, and she's got a great testimony that goes along with that too. So if you want to be encouraged, and somebody who's really gone through some trials and tribulation, come on out and hear how she answers these questions with humor. And then we're going to wind this up, sort of to get us through the rest of the year on Wednesday night with our last midweek group of the year. We're going to be going through the Christmas experience. This week we're looking at gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And we meet here about 6:30 for, we call it prayer or fellowship or gossip. You call it whatever you want. In our church we have different names for it. And we eat, because, you know, we meet, we got to eat. And then about 7 o'clock the lesson starts, and then we discuss it. And if you look at your brochures and you read them, it's gonna say, we at the Odyssey Church believe you learn more in circles than in circles. That's what happens when you proof your own work. We believe you learn more in circles than you do in rows, because in circles we can discuss what's going on. So meet us here at 6:30 for snacks and fellowship, and then the discussion starts at 7. And 2017, we've got two different midweek groups coming up. First of all, we have one that's going to be hosted right here in the sanctuary by Barbara Kaufman, and we're going to meet on Thursday instead of Wednesday. We're still going to keep the time at 7 o'clock. And it's knowing who you are in Christ, finding our identity in Christ, because a transformed mind will lead to a transformed life. And then our very own Sherry Kopelman is going to be hosting one at her house on forgiveness, perspectives on making peace with your past. And I don't know about you, but, you know, there's a lot of my past that would be great if I could just get that perspective and make peace with it. Meet at 7 o'clock on Wednesdays at her house. There's sign-up sheets out front with phone numbers and things like that if you would like to have some more information. But please sign up and join us. And then starting on January the 8th, again, a mistake on the inside bulletin. It says January the 9th, but Sunday, I believe, is actually the 8th. At 10 o'clock, we're going to be seeing Jesus through the eyes of the doctor. And if you don't know who the doctor is, well, you can just come here January 8th and you'll find out. So, as I promised, we're going to get all our church business out of the way first so that we can get and join this service together. So I'm going to ask the ushers to start to prepare for this evening's offering. But before I do, I just want to tell everybody, and there's people in here that don't normally come here that support this vision, but I want everybody in here that has been coming and has been supporting us in volunteers, in prayer, financially, all the resources, how much we truly appreciate you, how much that God has done, and a lot of you know it, through us, simply because of what you've done to help us out. And I just want everybody to know how much I truly appreciate it. But really, the Odyssey Church is a donor-funded church, which simply means that the largest majority of our funding and our resources come from outside of our church. We have a small congregation, and we've been very blessed. We have ministry partners all over the country, in our community, across the nation. And although we do have a very, very generous congregation, we're still poor, but we're growing, and God is blessing us. So, if there's a number of ways that you can help us out. The first one is just simply through prayer. If you would keep the Odyssey Church and what we do here in your prayers, we would certainly appreciate it. We've had the blessing of really helping out a church in, that does a lot of work in Haiti. So we're working in the world. We have helped many people here in the community, and we couldn't do it without God. There's not a thing in this church that can take place without God and His Holy Spirit. So just keep us in prayer. And then if you have some talents, you know, we're looking to really start and improve and get our children's ministry going by March. So if you like to work with children, please see me after the service. We can always use a drummer, a bass guitarist, all kinds of different musical talents. We're trying to grow our band. We got 6 or 7 people up here tonight, but man, we want to have a full orchestra. I'd love to have a fiddle player. Anybody play fiddle? Some people call them violins, but they're wrong. They're fiddles. And then, of course, you know, we can always use financial support. Yeah, it takes money to support a vision, and there's some brochures in your bulletin tonight. Tells you how you can do that in the easiest way. Of course, we take our offering tonight, but maybe you would consider even being a small ministry partner with us, and we really just appreciate it. But we thank you all for being here. I'm going to ask, if you will, please allow me to pray for the service as the offering's going around, and we'll watch the video, And then we'll get right into the service. All our church business is done, and we'll enjoy this together. So begin to prepare our hearts for God's word in both words and in music. And let me pray for the service. Heavenly Father, I thank you for each person that took time out of this busy, hectic, crazy time of year to come out and join us. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you're here present before we even arrive. And Father, we just ask tonight that you manifest yourself, that you show yourself in a great in a powerful way. Father, as we unwrap these gifts that you offer us, Lord, may we see individually and personally how you sent them for us. Father, tonight, Lord, take over this service. Protect the ones that are here. Watch over their finances. Watch over their families. Watch over their relationships. And Lord, as we go into 2017, let us keep our eyes squarely focused on you. Lord, let us and allow us through the power of the Holy Spirit, knowing that we can't do this on our own, be the Lord over our lives, that Jesus Christ is not only our Savior, but he's the one that we rely on, he's the one we listen to, he's the one that we're obedient to. And Father, give us this peace, this joy, this hope that you offer us through the ultimate gift, the indescribable gift of Jesus Christ. And I thank you in the name above all. Amen.
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 Somebody's going to give you the gift that you know, maybe you looked in the closet and you already know it's there, you just wait for tomorrow so you can open it. I know none of you would do that, but me. And maybe it's a late package, you were really hoping to be here before Christmas and it didn't make it. And again, maybe you're waiting for direction. You're at a crossroads and you just don't know which way to go. Maybe you're having a problem in your finances or your relationship, or maybe there's a bad medical report. You know, I know that a lot of us get to the point this time of year where we're just waiting for the craziness of this season to be over so we can get our life back to normal. We have really messed up what was supposed to be such an exciting time of year, such an exciting holiday, and made it so secular that we get stressed out. And maybe you just wait to return to normal on Monday or maybe Tuesday, you get the day off with Sunday falls, or Christmas falls on a Sunday this year. But whatever it is, I just encourage you. Even outside these doors, it'll still be there when you leave here. Let's just spend this Christmas Eve watching and waiting for the miracle of Christmas. Waiting for God. It's so hard to fathom the God of the universe, the one that always was, had no beginning, will have no end, came to earth as a baby. Sometimes you wonder, why would he come as a baby? You know? And I think one reason is, who's afraid of a baby? You know, the next time he shows up, if we read the Revelation and how that he's coming, we might be a little scared. But who's afraid of a baby? Jesus comes in this loving way. So to let you know, for those who haven't been here for the last 4 weeks, so the last 4 weeks we've been celebrating through the season of what they call Advent. And Advent is a Latin word, or derived from the Latin, it means the coming or the arrival. And the season is marked by expectation. It's marked by waiting, anticipation, and longing. But Advent just isn't an extension of Christmas. Sometimes we just think it's the thing that leads up to Christmas, or it's an extension of Christmas. It makes the holiday longer. But really, that's not what it is at all. It's actually a season that links the past, the present, and the future all together. See, Advent offers us an opportunity to share in this ancient longing. This ancient longing of the coming Messiah, the Christ. In fact, God's Word says that He has placed eternity in our heart. So if you've never accepted Christ, that feeling that you have that there's something beyond this world, that is the longing that we anticipate, that we wait for. This ancient longing of the coming of the Messiah, or the Christ. We celebrate His birth, but we're also, for those of us who are Jesus followers, for those of us who call ourselves Christians, we're also to be alert. We're supposed to be anticipating. It's a time to remember that not only did Jesus arrive in the form of a baby in His first advent, but He's returning again. There'll be a second advent, and we wait and we anticipate in the meantime. During the season of Advent, we light these candles on a wreath, and each one of the candles represents a different aspect to the world that was lost in. You got a little ways to go. So I just want you to know, you got a little ways to go. I'll let you know. During the season of Advent, we light these candles, and they represent the aspects of Jesus coming into this world that's filled with so much darkness. You know, and if you read the news and you pick up the paper, if they even still make papers, or look at your iPhones, you know that this world really has a lot of dark places in it. So each flame represents the gift that Jesus brings to us as He begins to light up the darkness that we could live in without Him. So tonight we're going to unwrap the gifts of hope and the gifts of love and the gifts of joy and the gifts of peace. And then we're going to finish by lighting the most important candle of all, the fifth candle on the wreath, the Christ candle. We're going to celebrate the gift of Jesus Himself. So the first gift we unwrap is the gift of hope. And while we all, you know, as we think of hope, most of us think of something that we're hoping for in the future. Something that we hope will happen. But God's gift of hope includes hope past, hope present, hope future. You know, think about this. What's the longest that you've ever waited for something? You know, there's a lot of things in my life that I've waited for, but one that came to mind as I was studying and preparing for this was before I was a teenager, when I was about 11 or 12 years old, I really wanted this mini bike. And I'm working hard, and I'm trying to save money, and I saved, and I saved, and I saved, and I'm waiting, and I'm waiting, and I'm waiting, and I'm really hoping that I'm going to be able to ride it and drive it. But it just seemed like the day would never come. It didn't matter how much I saved or how long I waited. I just didn't have all the money. I'd never going to reach my goal. Well, the people of Israel, they knew all about waiting. Their entire history was marked for waiting. For thousands of years. Thousands. Think about it. Thousands of years. They had waited and they longed for and expected God to fulfill His original promise to send them a Messiah, to send them a Savior, a Christ. who set them free. Now, these prophets of old, one of them was by the name of Isaiah, had not forgotten about his promises, that God would still come through. And maybe tonight, you've read the scriptures, you know of God's promises, but you're in a time of waiting. And I think about this, as more and more time passed, as generations came and went, you know, they could look back at what these prophets had foretold, for what Isaiah had foretold. In chapter 9 of the book of Isaiah, verse 6, it says, "For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." And I think about this, it had been thousands of years. I mean, some of the people, don't you think they probably got a little discouraged? I mean, they hadn't seen the fulfillment of this Messiah God had promised them for so long. And maybe they did what I did with that mini bike. You know, I have to be honest, I settled for second best. I got tired of waiting. I got impatient. Now, other than you know me, you know I'm a very patient person. The giggling is from the people that know me. I got impatient. I bought a stereo. I mean, how do you go from a mini bike to a stereo? Because the stereo was cheaper, and I got tired of waiting. I settled for second best. And I'm sure many of these Israelites, as they've been waiting for so long, many of them, they got discouraged. Maybe they walked away, or they settled for less. Especially as these generations came and gone, and they had a choice to make. They had a choice, just like we had a choice to make. They could have lost hope and walked away. They could have settled for second best. Or they could have drawn renewed hope from the future and what God had promised in the past. And we all have that same choice this evening. We can give up. We can settle for less. Or we can thank God for what He has done for us. And we can look at His promises to us and be reminded that He's fulfilled His promises in the past, and He will fulfill His promises again. But just like the Israelites, it's our choice. We have to make that conscious decision to do that. The gift of hope reminds us of the promises and the prophecies that were fulfilled in Jesus' coming into the world. They show us that God was working through all those years, that He was working all along. Even though it was very difficult to see Him, it was difficult to keep on waiting, it is a reminder of the hope that we can have because He's fulfilled these promises in the past. And as we reflect on the hope through Advent and Christmas time, we too, me and you, we too, can look back on God's faithful in our lives with 20/20 hindsight. And I look back on my life and the stupid things that I did and the mistakes that I made, and all along as I look back, I can see that God was there all the time. But sometimes we're in the midst of the troubles, in the midst of the circumstances. There's a saying that says you can't see the forest because of the trees, and we get mixed up in it. It's so hard to see God. So we reflect on with perfect 20/20 hindsight, knowing what He's done for us in the past and knowing that He's going to fulfill His promises in the future. But we have to choose to do that. We gain hope and confidence in what God is going to do in the present and in our future because of what He has done for us in the past. For us, we can look back on the birth of Jesus Christ. But the season of Advent reminds us to wait and to expect that He's coming again. And that is still future to us. It reminds us that God is a God who keeps His promises. And He may not have fulfilled them yet, but He will, because God always keeps His promise. We long for this time when all will be restored, when all will be made right, when all will be made new. And we can suffer we can experience the pain and the suffering of the day, the things that we go through while we wait in this eager hope for the future when God will make all things right. And this type of hope that the Bible speaks about, that these ancient scriptures have, isn't a hope like, I hope to win the lottery. And I don't know if any one of you are in here or the one that won the lottery over here at Goose Creek, the $1 million ticket. If you were, I just just want to remind you that Odyssey Church is a good place to tithe. 10% of a million, in case you don't know, is $100,000, okay? Just in case you want to write a check tonight. But anyway, this hope, these ancient scriptures we call our Bible speaks of, it isn't the kind of hope that we so often talk about today. Like most people understand hope is, hey, I hope something's going to happen in the future. This isn't what these scriptures mean when they say hope. The biblical definition of hope is a confident expectation. It's not a wishful thinking. It is a confident expectation. It's a hope. It's a firm assurance regarding things which are unclear and unknown. Unclear and unknown. Maybe that's where you're at right now in your life. You have some things going on, and it's just not clear what you should do. The future's unknown. But you can have confident expectation because of the hope that we have through Jesus Christ. According to the authors of the book of Lamentations and the book of Job, without hope, life loses its meaning. According to the prophet Isaiah in his writings, in death, there is no hope without the hope that we find through God in the fulfillment of Jesus Christ as Savior. And really, I think that most of us, deep down, whether you follow Christ or not, can agree with these statements. Goes on to say that the righteous, and the only way to be righteous in God's eye, I remind you, is to make Jesus Christ, and Christ is means Messiah, it actually means anointed one. Christ wasn't his last name. Jesus, the anointed of God, it says that the Bible says the way to be righteous with God is put our faith in him, the Christ, and make him Lord over our life. And when we put our faith in his Son, we have a great confidence. We have a great confidence, great expectation, great hope of God's protection and help, and can be freed from our fears and from our anxieties and our worries. And these are the great gifts of hope we all get to unwrap this evening if we choose to do so. But what about today? What about the here and now? What about our present circumstances? In the first chapter of Luke, we find Jesus' birth as foretold by Mary, by the angel Gabriel. Maybe you're like me sometimes, in the midst of our troubles, in the midst of life's questions, in the midst of our concerns, don't we just sort of wish Gabriel would show up and tell us what to expect? Would it be easier just to know what's going to happen? In Mary's case, I don't know if it would have been. It may have been easier not to know what was going to go on. I mean, what do you do with information like Mary got? What if God came to you and told you something like he told Mary? How would you have handled it? This unexpected news that your life is about to change, and it's going to change in a big way. And it's going to be the most difficult thing you could ever imagine yourself going through. But in the end, it's going to be okay. In the end, it's going to be worth it. And not only is it going to be worth it for you, it's going to be worth it for everybody else around you as well. Maybe even as with Mary, it's going to be worth it for everybody in the world as well. I mean, what do you do when life gets tough? What do you do in circumstances that are unclear and unknown? We have a choice. We can respond as Mary did. Thankfully, Mary responded in faith. She held fast to the hope of the angel's message. She made a decision to hope that what was impossible would be possible, and that the Messiah, this Christ child, was going to be coming, and he was going to be coming through her. Because of the life and the birth and the death and the resurrection of Jesus, we can have hope in our present situation, no matter what our struggles are, no matter what our circumstances are. Our present hope in Jesus Christ will not stop the storms of life. I wish I could tell you that it would. I wish that it did. But it doesn't change the immediate situations that we face or the consequences of our actions or our bad decisions. It doesn't change sometimes the consequences of the actions and the bad decisions of others that affect our life. But as Hebrews 6:19 describes, it's our hope as an anchor for our soul. It's firm and secure. It's like an anchor that holds a ship steady against the winds and the waves. Our hope holds us firm and secure in the midst of life's storms. Let this season of Advent, this season of Christmas, be one of secure hope in the midst of whatever storms you may be facing, or whatever storms you may have to face in 2017. But you have the ability, you get to choose to have this hope. And nobody can make that decision for you. You get to choose it. And the good news is, nobody can make the decision for you not to have, because you get to choose. God is still large, and God is still in charge. God is still on the throne. God is still at work. He's delivered on His promises past, and He'll make all things right in the future. Amen. And in the present, our hope lies in the fact that this baby who was born in a stable in Bethlehem has come, and that He'll return again. And in the meantime, He is with us, filling us with hope. And I ask you, if you will, let's stand together and sing O Holy Night. And as you stand, I'm going to ask Michael Middendorf to light the first candle of Advent, the candle of hope. And we're going to sing O Holy Night together. The words should be in your voice. That was terrible. You were the first one to look at it. All right. We'll be led by the oddities.
Holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long may the world in sin error pining, till He appear and the soul. Thank you.
By the things that need to get done, by work, by children, by the the things that we have to take care of. Sometimes, even in the holiday where we most celebrate his birth and his love for us, and the fact that he sent his son, is the easiest time to become distracted. It's easy to read the headlines of the paper and wonder if love really truly can overcome the darkness and the hate of this world. It's easy to allow worry over tomorrow or over next week or even next year to overwhelm us and keep us from feeling the love that God desires for us to have, that he desires for us to feel. But it's important to remember that God invites us, invites each one of us on a very personal level. And he invites you and he invites me to bring all these cares that we have, all those worries, all these concerns, all these things that keep us up at night, and bring them to him. But as I read through the scriptures, I find out God just doesn't ask you or ask me to ignore those things that are going on in our lives, to ignore the things that distract us in order to experience his love. Because if he did, we couldn't. We would be so distracted. We couldn't experience his love. He doesn't ask us to rid ourselves of the hurry and the worry of this world. Instead, he invites us to surrender our deepest hurts, to give him our most difficult pains of our lives, and just give them to him and allow him to fill us with his love. And the good news, the love that God gives you through his son Jesus Christ, it's enough. His love is enough to carry you through the darkest doubts of your mind, your most difficult pains. His hope is enough to lead us into healing. The love of Christ is fierce. The love of Christ is a powerful love. Apostle Paul describes it this way in a letter that he wrote to the Christians in Rome. Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, or anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. As we welcome Jesus, not into the world, but into our world, this is the kind of love we can experience in a new way and in a deeper way. As God loves, works through us and in us, it begins to transform us. Fills us and it overflows us, and it comes from us and runs out into others. See, here's the beautiful thing about God's love, is that sharing this gift of love that he gives us doesn't leave us with less love. It actually gives us more love. One of Jesus' closest friends when he was on earth, a man by the name of John, described this process for us in his first epistle, or his first letter. 1 John chapter 4, verse 9. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us. And he sent his Son as an atonement. Atonement means at one man. He sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice, as a sacrifice to make us at one with God because of our sins. John says, dear friends, since God so loved us, shouldn't we love one another? This is the gift of love we unwrap. This is the gift of love we celebrate at Christmas. It is God's ultimate gift for us to receive and experience and share his love. So may we experience God's love in a new and in a deeper way this season and throughout 2017 and always. Will you stand with me tonight as we sing Away in the Manger? And as you're standing, I'm going to ask Mike to light the second candle, the second candle of Advent, the candle of love. Thank you. Christianity does not hinge on the birth of Christ. It hinges on something that's just as amazing, though. Christianity hinges on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus purchased our reconciliation with God. Jesus, and through Jesus, we can become righteous. We can become holy. Not because of anything we did. We're not holy. We're not righteous because of what we have done, but because of what Jesus has done. Jesus gives us His righteousness. He imparts His holiness upon us. And because He does, we can now stand in the presence of a holy God. This indescribable gift, God in the flesh, shines through the wrapping paper and gives us hope and gives us love and gives us joy and gives us peace. But so often, in the hurriedness of the world, we forget what Jesus has done for us and what it cost Him on our behalf. And Jesus knew that. Jesus knew we're forgetful people. So He gave us a way to remember. And He tells us this is a way to remember what He's done for us in the past. It's a way to remember what He's doing for us right now. And it's a way to remember what He's going to do for us in the future. It's a way to remember His promises for the future. Jesus said, "This is My body, which is given for you. Do this to remember Me." In the same way, He took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant between God and His people. It's an agreement confirmed with My blood. Do this as often as you drink it." Apostle Paul tells us, "For every time we eat the bread and we drink of the cup, we are announcing the Lord's death until He comes again." So as we read these verses in 1 Corinthians, what we see is past, present, and future. what Jesus did for us in the past, what Jesus is doing for us right now, and what Jesus will do for us in the future. We can have hope. We can have love. We can have joy. We can have peace. No matter what is going on, because what Jesus has done for us, for what He will do for us, and because of this indescribable gift of Jesus Christ, which God has given to us, and what He will do for us again. So I'm going to ask my wife Janet and my daughter Taylor to come up to the table first and to help me serve these elements. The Lord invites you to His table. And He invites us to remember all who love Him, all who have repented of their sin, all who seek Him and live in peace with one another are invited. Aren't they beautiful? I am trying to get the big gift for Christmas.
But you did that, though.
On a night when He gave Himself up, and He gave Himself up for us, He took the bread, and He gave thanks to the Father. And He broke the bread, gave it to His disciples. And He said, "Take, eat. This is My body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." In the same way, after the supper was over, He took the cup and again gave thanks to the Father. And then He gave it to His disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. They're going to serve the musicians next so they can play. And then I ask you to come forward. Come if you want to take and partake in this sacred ceremony. I just want you to know this is a service not to be rushed, but to be cherished. Take your time. Come up to center aisle. Take the bread. Dip it into the juice, and then if you would like, spend time at the altar. The cup over which give thanks to the sharing of the blood of Christ. The bread is a reminder of the body. I don't know whether you've ever thought about this before or not, but the bread was wheat living in a field. It was alive. But it had to be given for us to have physical nourishment. It had to be given to be made into bread. Jesus said, called Himself, "I am the bread of life." And just as that wheat had to be given and made into bread for us to be fed physically so that we could live physically, Jesus had to give His life so that we could be fed spiritually, so that we could live spiritually. The grape was hanging on the tree. It was alive. In order to make the juice, it had to be squeezed. The juice had to be poured out. just as we are fed, or we are and partaking the juice to live physically. Jesus poured out his blood so that we could live spiritually. You're welcome to come. Anybody on the first row would like to come, you come up first. And then after they're done serving, they'll serve me, and we'll go to our third gift. Song by Kyle too. He wrote the song, so praise God. All right. right, so far this evening we have unwrapped the gifts of hope and we have unwrapped the gifts of love. And now we're about to unwrap our third gift, the gift of joy. And joy is a great big giant gift in a very small package because it's more than a feeling. You know, so often in this world, circumstances tell us whether we're happy or not. But joy goes so much deeper. The arrival of Jesus created a joy which caused all of creation to celebrate. It's this joy it's the joy that was described in the Psalms. It's a joy that was described in Psalms such as Psalm 96, verses 11 through 13. It says, let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the sea resound and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Let all the trees of the forest sing for joy. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord. What if you just don't feel joy this time of year, this Christmas season? I mean, there's plenty of expectation and busyness and stress and darkness in the world. And those kind of things can rob us of our joy, not only during the Christmas season, but during the rest of the year as well. How can I receive this gift of joy even in the midst of suffering, in the midst of loneliness or grief or stress or boredom or busyness or anything else which keeps us up at night? Those things that seek to rob and destroy us. Let us look at a moment at how we can anticipate and we can recognize and how we can actually choose to. Again, it's a decision that we get to make. And we can do this by looking at a couple of the characters in this historical Christmas account to show us the way. You know, the shepherds that night, the night Jesus was, they're a great example of anticipating joy. Now, initially, they weren't anticipating joy. They were on the clock. It's just another night in the field doing the normal grind, day-to-day work of their jobs. And then all of a sudden the sky lights up. And it lights up with angels and a message about the Messiah. That was unexpected. It was pretty scary. In fact, Luke, this medical doctor who carefully investigated everything I've written. So these shepherds, not only did they not feel joy right away, they felt scared. In fact, he goes even as far to say they were terrified. It tells us the angels said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Messiah, the Lord. See, the first thing the angel does is he addresses their fear. And then he helps them move beyond their fear to receive this message of joy. The Savior, the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed of God, the one that Israel had anticipated and waited for so long, he's been born. By the end of the night, the shepherds, they finally got it. They got this joy. My prayer has been this week that no matter where you're at, that before you leave here tonight, that you get it as well. That you can get this joy that God offers us. Luke says later that they returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard. And they were just as they had been told. I pray that we do the same thing, that we go out, that we glorify, that we praise God for what we have seen and heard. Even in the most difficult times, even when the things of the world seek to rob and destroy our joy. You know, elsewhere in the scriptures, it talks about the wise men, or you may have heard them called the Magi. They see a star in the sky, and they pay attention. They recognize the sign, and they travel along, and they traveled a long way. It was a travel that took 2 or 3 years to find this one whose birth was announced by the star. And in this period of time that they're traveling through the countries, you know that they had to encounter some hardships along the way. That didn't stop them. They kept on seeking anyway. Even when things got tough and when things went wrong, they kept on going. Through their journey, their response. It was one not a fear and sadness and what's going to happen. Scriptures tell us it was one of worship. It was one of joy. It was one of praise. Matthew, who was another one of Jesus' close friends, and I don't know what you've ever done in your life, but I don't believe anybody here was as bad or as hated as Matthew was. But when he found Jesus, things changed for him. Not only did Jesus change the world, he changed Matthew's world. He's changed my world. For people in here, I know, I've seen it. It's changed your world. And Matthew writes a gospel, or actually gospel is just a history of Jesus' life. And beginning in Matthew chapter 2, verse 10, Matthew records, when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw this child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and they worshipped him. I think we all know it can be hard to recognize joy in our lives sometimes, especially when it doesn't look like the way we would expect it to. When it have this joy that doesn't look like it should look like. See, we want joy to be free of worry and free of hardships. But James, and James is, most people believe, and I believe, was actually the half-brother of Jesus. He tells us that this joy can be found in the midst, and sometimes even because of the difficult things that we go through. James writes, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. And so many people misinterpret that voice. He's not telling you that the trial, you have to be joyful because of the trial. There's some trials that we have in life that you can't be joyful about. But he says, here's why you can be joyful. You have to know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. He goes on later to say, it will form you into the image of Jesus Christ. You don't consider it joy because this trial you're going through, you consider it joy because what this trial is transforming you into and creating you to be. You know, I'm a living example of this verse. My faith tests come in all kinds of ways, and most of the time they are painful. Most of the time they aren't pleasant. But if my eyes were on my own happiness, I couldn't make it. My eyes weren't on the joy of the Lord. If I wasn't resting in His joy and not in my happiness, I'd be in trouble most of the time. So how do I? How can you? How can we do this? And we begin by making a conscious decision. We begin by choosing, by making this constant decision to direct our path toward joy. And we do that through gratitude and obedience and by continual abiding or continually persisting in Jesus Christ and His promises. And when we do, we open ourselves up to being shaped and transformed by God Himself. And we, me and you, we get to encounter joy as a result of this. As we celebrate Christmas, we know that the Christ, the Messiah, the Lord has come. And we can celebrate and rejoice over this wonderful news, this good news that is for all the people. Because we know, even if it's deep down in our hearts, we know there's more to come. We know that eventually Jesus Christ will return. We know that all things will be made right. We know deep down in our hearts that there's more to this life than this life. This eventual return. We still have to anticipate that. But let us experience Christmas as a time of gratitude, time of obedience, time of abiding, time of persisting in God's love as we anticipate the joy Jesus brings us, brings both to you and to me individually, to each one of us, and corporately as the body of Christ. Again, I'm going to ask you to stand with me, and together we'll sing Joy to the World. As I stand, I'm going to ask Mike to light our third candle, the pink candle. Let's sing Joy to the World.
Joy in the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive the King. Let every heart return in blue, and
counting toys.
Jesus came as the Prince of Peace. He brings us first and foremost, and most importantly, peace with God. He is the only way we can be restored into a relationship by God and with God by the forgiveness of our sin, which has separated us from God. Eternal restoration and peace with our Creator is the greatest gift we can ever receive this season. And the good news is, it's available to each one of us. We just have to accept it. God hands us the gift, and all we have to do is take it. And when we do, we begin to encounter Jesus. And we can relate to Him. And we get to experience His peace, even in our here and now. The Apostle Paul tells us this: the Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer, petition, and with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. What wonderful words. The peace of God found through Jesus Christ goes beyond all of our understanding. It shows up in situations where it doesn't make sense, where it doesn't naturally make sense that it should show up. And then it holds us and it guides us through our worst nightmares and our most stressful circumstances. Peace, which is found in God through Christ, it's like His love. It's powerful. It's strong. It guards our hearts. It guards our minds. And it's stronger than whatever difficulty, whatever it is that we're facing. But we forget sometimes that God gave us this peace in the form of a man. He gave us this peace in the form of Jesus Christ, who is the Prince of Peace. Notice in that first verse, which I believe is from Philippians, it says, the Lord is near. See, Jesus' presence is with us. That's the reason we don't have to be anxious. He is Emmanuel. He is God with us. He is the Savior. He is the one who offers us this gift of peace. This peace that's beyond all understanding. This peace that guards our minds and guards our heart. And as we practice these actions, he tells us what to do to get it. He says that we have to pray. We have to petition God. Can you imagine the God of all creation, the God of the universe, has come before me and asked me and petitioned me for the things that you need. That we're to come to him with thanksgiving. And as we do this, we begin to know God. We begin to know Jesus, who is God, and not just know about him. And when we begin to know him, he begins to transform us. And peace comes as a result of that transformation. We experience it as the Holy Spirit begins to shape our perspective and it realigns our heart. Our troubles may rage on, but the Spirit gives us new eyes to see, and the peace of Jesus Christ guards us and calms us and changes our outlook. He's the one who gives us peace to come with this promise. He is with us. He is Emmanuel, God with us. And Jesus tells us, and it's recorded again by his disciple John in the 16th chapter of the Gospel, or the history of Jesus' life, verse 33. And John heard these words personally. He wrote what he heard Jesus say and what came out of his eyes. He said, I have told you these things so that you may have peace. In this world you will. And I want you to notice, it doesn't say you might, it didn't say you could, it doesn't say that you... It sometimes might be a little bit, it says you will have trouble. But he goes on to say, take heart, because I have overcome. There is peace this evening. There is peace in these chaotic times, and there is a complete peace that is yet to come. And in the time in between, the time in which we live in right now, in this very moment, we can make a decision. We can choose. We can choose to trust in Jesus' promise that he has indeed overcome the world. And in this, not only can we have peace, but we can have joy, and we can have joy as well. Will you stand with me again as we sing, Let There Be Peace on Earth? As you stand, once again, I'm going to ask you to light the fourth candle of Advent, the candle of peace. Let there be peace on earth, and let it start with me.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as our fathers, brothers all are we. Let
Christmas services you could have attended, but you chose to be here, and I am so thankful. Thank you for taking this journey towards Bethlehem with me and unwrapping these gifts along the way. You know, we arrive at Christmas Eve. We're headed towards Christmas Day, and we celebrate this baby that was wrapped in cloth and laid in a manger. And I think we all know that this baby Jesus is the true gift of Christmas. All these other gifts, the gifts of hope and the gifts of joy and the gift of peace and the gift of love, they all come through Him. He is the hope bringer. Jesus is love come down. He is the Messiah, the joy giver. He is the Lord who is the peacemaker. As we've shown throughout the night, Jesus is the bringer of eternal life. And He can, if we will simply allow Him, He can restore our relationship with God. He is the giver of life. He is the giver of life to the full, as described in John 10:10. He is the way, the truth, and the life, as described in John 14:6. He is everything. He is the miracle. So humble. But the problem is He's so humble that so many people miss it. He's the gift who entered on that dark and that very normal night 2,000 years ago as a fragile infant and became one of us. Can you imagine how much it took for Him to take off the robes of heaven and put on the flesh of man? Let us remember He is the God who is so loving and so powerful that He willingly stretched out His arms on a cross later in His life so that He could carry our sin and our shame and our burdens and even our death in order to give us a way to Himself. God sent God to save us from the wrath of God. Jesus is the indescribable gift, the greatest gift of Christmas, the greatest gift of all eternity. And as we celebrate this gift of Jesus this Christmas, may we be filled with hope. May we be filled with love. May we be filled with joy. May we be filled with peace so we can live life and live it to the fullest, both in this world and the next world. And if you don't know, if you don't know how to have this indescribable gift, let me introduce you to Jesus right after the service. You just see me. It would be my great pleasure to introduce you to Jesus. So as we begin to wrap this up, candles of hope and love and joy and peace, they've all been lit. And now I'm going to ask Mike to light the center candle, the white candle, the Christ candle. So this is where our Advent journey ends and a new journey begins. A journey of worship. It's our act of worship to receive the gifts of Jesus this Christmas. And we can respond by bringing our own worship to Him. Like Mary and Joseph, like the shepherds, like the angels, like the wise men, we can rejoice in His coming, and we worship Emmanuel, God with us. Together we have watched. Together we have waited. We have stepped out of the darkness and followed the light. We received the gifts of Christmas. Tonight, as we have lit the final candle in our Advent wreath, the Christ candle, let us worship our King. Prophet Isaiah, approximately 760 years before Jesus was even born, said, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you." Jesus Himself makes this claim, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows Me will never walk in darkness, because you will have the light that leads to life." Tonight, the final candle, the Christ candle, has been lit. And it's reaching out for you. The light of the world has come to earth, and it's trying to reach you. Jesus is extending His hope. Jesus is extending His love, His joy, His peace to you and to me, because He is God who is love. Let us arise and shine and worship Him and love Him in return. The question now becomes, we accept these gifts from God. We experience the miracle. Will you receive God's greatest gift, His one and only Son who was born to set you free? Will you give him your heart this Christmas in worship and in wonder? Stand with me, if you will, as we sing Silent Night. And as you stand, I'm going to once again remind you that the Christ candle has now been lit. He's going to light his candle. You all should have candles like this in your seats. And what Mike's going to do is he's going to light his candle from the center of the candle, the Christ candle. And then he's going to walk over to Carolyn, and he's going to light her candle. Mike. Now, the easiest way to do this, if you're the one having your candle lit, is to hold your candle straight up and let the other person light your candle. That way, your candle doesn't fall out and you drop wax all over for you. Or your hand. Because we don't have any great insurance. No, I just... He'll light Janet's candle, and then he'll come over and light Jillian's candle. Jillian will light your candle. You'll light his candle, and so forth and so on until all the candles are lit, and we'll light them as we're saying. And after we're done, please just remain standing until the very end of the service. Contradictory. The kingdom of God is here. Repent and believe the good news and accept God's gift of Jesus Christ. Accept the gifts of hope and love and joy and peace that He brings. But here's the paradox. We live in there already, but not quite yet. Christ has come into His world. His birth, His ministry, His crucifixion, His resurrection, it's already taken place. It's been recorded in both secular and in church history. And if the kingdom of God has been established in our hearts, then we are citizens of an eternal realm. Christ has come in the world. He's offered us this eternal hope. But we're in the already, but not quite yet. because he's coming back. And we'll not fully experience all of God's plans until he does return. And he's promised he's returned. We're going to keep our candles lit, and we're all going to walk into the foyer. And when we gather around together, we'll sing happy birthday to our Savior, Jesus Christ, and then we're going to blow out our candles together. And as we're walking, let's walk in silence, taking time to reflect on the gifts of Christmas, taking time to reflect on the gifts of hope, and love, and joy, and peace through God's greatest gift, the indescribable gift of Jesus Christ. But let us not leave these gifts under the tree. What good is a gift that's left under the tree? Let's step out of the darkness and into the light that Jesus has brought. Jesus has transformed us. Unto us, a child has been born. A son has been given. Let us celebrate Emmanuel, God with us. The birth of Jesus Christ, who came to save us from our sins and the wrath of God. The one who gives us hope, the one who gives us love, the one who gives us joy, the one who gives us peace. So follow me into the lobby, we'll get around the birthday cake and we'll sing.